Hi, everyone. Lance Mehta with you. Welcome to the latest episode of Rooted in Ivy, as we bring on former Ivy League athletes to discuss how the league and their experience attending an Ivy League institution helped shape their careers on and off the playing surface, as well as their latest ventures and projects. And today we are very excited to talk with Brown's all-time leading scorer in men's basketball, fourth all-time leading scorer in Ivy League history from the Brown class of 2003, none other than Earl Hunt. Earl, thanks for joining us. Hope you and yours are safe and healthy. How's everything on your end?
Everything is well. I feel very fortunate. Mine are safe and healthy, and my kids are going to school in New York. So feel very blessed from that standpoint, given everything that's happening in the world.
Well, that is certainly good to hear. I want to start with your basketball career, because you started to attend Brown, I would argue, when it was really a turning point for the men's basketball program. You come in 1999. Glenn Miller also simultaneously takes over as the head coach, and you little by little put together one winning campaign after another. So what drew you to Brown, specifically what they were doing on the basketball court, and what do you attribute to why things progressively were able to turn around so quickly?
Well, I have to give a lot of credit to Glenn Miller, the former head coach. I also have to give a lot of credit to Mike Martin, the current head coach, who came on as a sophomore and provided an extensive level of leadership that foreshadowed him becoming a head coach at Brown eventually. I think what really attracted me to Brown was the open curriculum. I had a visit with a guy by the name of Omari Ware, who was from the DC area, similar to myself. And I really fell in love with the campus and the school when I came. And there was a belief that we were going to turn the basketball program around. And that actually came to fruition. Knowing what I know now, maybe I wouldn't have stepped into a program that was 4-22, but at 17, you felt like you could change anything. And when I had my visit to College Hill, I was extremely excited. It was everything about Brown I just really enjoyed. And I took a leap of faith.
Well, that leap of faith paid off big time, because you helped lead the school to three straight winning seasons, two straight 17-win campaigns. And then, of course, the only NIT appearance in school history as a senior when you went up against Virginia in the third round. What was it like, Earl, to take part in all of these milestones that it seemed like you were accomplishing with your teammates, of course, each and every season?
You know, it's funny. I think as an old guy now, you reflect back on these milestones. But when you're going through them, I think that the team and the players we had an expectation that we'd win. And we didn't care. The history of Brown at that point wasn't winning in basketball. We were more in the moment. I know I certainly felt, as well as Elahi Nuliatia, as well as Jason Fortes of the world, Mike Martins, that we were as good as any team. And we never thought like, wow, you know, we're having a winning season, or Brown shouldn't be winning. We had an expectation, that group of guys, that we expected to win, wanted to win, and we prepared to win. So what had happened before us wasn't really on our mind. Now, 20 years later, I look back and I'm like you. I'm like, wow, we really accomplished a lot in that context. But during those 4 years, I don't think any of us were thinking about that.
Well, speaking of maybe putting things in perspective later on in life, you're the only Brown men's basketball player to score over 2,000 points. Now, I'm not saying that maybe at the point in which you accomplished that, Earl, you were putting it in context, but now, after you're a few years removed from your playing career, I mean, how big is that to see yourself atop the scoring list amongst anybody else that ever put on a Brown uniform?
Well, let's put it this way. Based on how I play now, I need to remember that, Earl Hunt. And I look back at that with a smile. You know, you feel good about certain accomplishments in life. And it was a function. I had some really great teammates, some great point guards. I probably shot a little bit too much. And you realize for 4 years, you were really excelled at something you did. And it's something that I cherish, certainly. But, you know, somebody's going to break that record soon. I'm holding my breath now. And the next 4 years, Mike Martin is bringing in the new Earl Hunt to score 2,000 points.
Well, speaking of records, when I was going through some of your milestones, the one that jumped out to me, Earl, I don't know if you remember this, your freshman year, your second Ivy League game, you pour in 39 points against Harvard. And that had set a Pizzatola Sports Center record, which has since been tied, of course, by Sean McGonigal. But you had 30 in the first half and you made a school record 17 free throws. I'm curious what you remember from that contest, given the fact that you were only a freshman. I mean, you were just getting your feet wet within Ivy League play.
Well, what I remember about that contest was there was a guy on the team who was excellent at Harvard. I won't name a name. And I think I had heard that, you know, the coaches had him higher than me when I was a senior in high school. So I wasn't too happy about that. And those were one of those games you circled. And then I also remember just making a few shots. And the next thing you know, you kind of felt like you couldn't miss. And anyone who's had those moments in basketball, you almost feel like you're outside of yourself and you can do no wrong. And I kind of felt that early in the game. And it's been great because there's a guy who I work with now, Tim Hill, who's at DeMatha, used to beat up on my high school team all the time. And I went to Brown and he went to Harvard. We knew each other. So after the game, I was able to send him a text and say, you know, high school's over. It's going to be different in college. So that was kind of cool as well.
You brought up Jason Forte, who is one of the players that you were able to play with, and three players from your senior class were named first team All Ivy, which was the first program to do that outside, of course, of Penn and Princeton. So it was nice to join those two top level tier teams in men's basketball in the Ivy League. But I was curious because I believe Forte is also a Maryland native. Earl, so how much did you interact with him going back to your high school days? How closely were you aligned with him before the both of you played together at Brown?
Yeah, Jason was an excellent player and drove a lot of success at Brown. I actually knew Jason's brother, Joe, who played at North Carolina. We were the exact same year in high school, and he was at a rival high school, DeMatha, which I just spoke about earlier. So I knew the Forte family pretty well. And Jason was like 2 years younger, where he was a pretty good high school player. But I remember, and we knew each other, but I was older, and that made a bigger difference in high school. And after my freshman year of college, I went to a place where a lot of the players in the area would go play. And Jason had grown maybe like 4 inches. And I was like, he's no longer Joe's little brother. And he was terrific. And Glenn Miller called me shortly thereafter, said, what do you think about this kid, Jason Forte? I was like, he's great. He's like, we need to start recruiting him because he's our top priority for the future. And man, we'd spent some time together. And when he came to Brown, he changed the whole dynamic of our team with his speed, his quickness, and his tenacity. So he was a great addition.
Yeah, the depth really showcased, specifically your senior year when you had so many offensive weapons. No surprise that you ultimately finished second in the Ivy League and made the NIT. And you mentioned Joe Forte, who then went on to play in the NBA for a little bit with the Celtics and the Sonics. I'm curious, Earl, given how accomplished you were as a basketball player, one of the most elite scorers in Ivy League history, before you went into finance, which we're going to get into, of course, shortly, how much did you consider maybe having a chance to continue your basketball career on a professional level?
Sure. Well, when I graduated from college, I was an alternate for one of the NBA draft camps, Portsmouth. And then I went and played professionally in Portugal for a year, which was excellent. It was an incredible experience living internationally, something I wanted to do in college, but obviously being a student athlete with the basketball season wasn't an option. So I certainly thought a lot about it. I think that's the beauty of the Ivy League is, you know, you don't really give up anything. Is I really pitch potential student athletes at the college ranks. The Ivy League is a great opportunity because you don't really lose much in terms of things you can do after college. It's a great platform to do a variety of things to go professional in. And you can still, if you're good enough, they'll find you. I just wasn't quite good enough. So, but I certainly thought about it and enjoyed playing in Europe for a year.
Well, I'm glad you brought up that aspect of your life, but you also brought up how when you attended Brown, it wasn't just the focus on basketball. Of course, anybody that is familiar with the Ivy League, education plays a slightly important role, I would say, right, in terms of balancing both. And you earned a degree in economics. So how much were you preparing for a profession in finance? How much did that interest you, even in maybe the earlier stages of life?
Well, you know, I wasn't as familiar with Wall Street when I went to Brown. And to be fair, I chose to be an economics major because I looked at the other stuff and said, I'm going to need a job when I'm done. And people said, if you're an econ major, you can figure something out. I actually learned more about Wall Street and finance through osmosis, which is a real benefit of being at a place like Brown, because a lot of my teammates or friends said, you know, one said, I'm getting an internship at this bank, I'm getting an internship at that bank. You're around these people where these are aspirational jobs, but you're around them and you kind of look and they're your friend. You're like, well, he's not that smart, or she's not quite as smart as this person. And you start saying, well, maybe I can do that too. And that was a real benefit of, you know, for me going to Brown was the exposure of your peers that were so smart and interesting. And yet you got to know them in a very intimate way. You started to realize things about yourself that you might be kind of special too and can do these things. And it was really through that networking with my friends and classmates and hearing about the different things they were going to do that I started to investigate more. And the alumni network was spectacular as well in helping me learn more about different careers. And it was really through word of mouth and networking with my friends that I said, wow, this is something that's interesting. And I learned more about it. And I got really excited.
It's interesting to hear you discuss the interaction you had with your classmates. And I'm wondering, because I often look at the parallels, Earl, between sports and other walks of life. And we know competition is synonymous with being a basketball player. Wall Street, I can only imagine, is pretty cutthroat. How much does that relate to the competitive edge that you built as an athlete? What you then maybe utilized as part of your skill set in achieving success on Wall Street?
You know, I would say in terms of Wall Street, it certainly is competitive, but almost any role you're competitive within the confines of working with a team. So the parallel really is if you're working on a project, people have different positions, they play to their strengths. The whole is greater than the parts as you work together cohesively. And so while there's certain pressures to perform and expectations and accountability, just like you have in sports, really the people that end up excelling, you know, at least at the firms that I've worked at in the roles I've had, are the ones that can take a piece of that and also really exert that feel in working with teams. And I think, you know, that's why I say team sports, I find prepare you for finance, but a variety of professional roles.
So you joined Goldman Sachs as a VP in 2015, currently serve as a partner in the securities division. What do you do in your current role if you were to give a proper synopsis of what you do?
Sure. So in my current role, I cover some of our largest clients, mostly alternative asset managers, but also real money asset accounts to provide the breadth of the services of Goldman Sachs for them globally. I focus on the global markets, but for some of these accounts, I'm responsible for the relationship across our firm. It's to make sure we are able to service them all their needs that they have so they can accomplish their goals.
Now, you're talking about through Goldman Sachs, VP, managing director, partner, and then you spent, of course, 11 years prior at Citi, in which you also gradually worked your way up. How much did getting in early and getting your feet wet in some of those other positions really help you in terms of what your current role is right now?
Sure. I think my current role is a culmination of what I've learned in each of my prior roles to do what I do at this point in my career, which is covering these clients for a broad array of products globally. What I would say is each role, you learn a little bit about what's gonna help you be successful in the next role. And it's not just about, it's really the EQ of people, it's situations, it's taking on more responsibility, it's managing, it's learning how to drive teams. You get some of those things from sports and from school, but there's nothing like on-the-job training as far as that's concerned. And also, there's a tenacity to move up each level that you carry with you as well. You know, you call them war wounds, but more or less, it's helping you become stronger. And through each of those points, you build a little bit better of a network. There's no one that is excellent at anything the first time they do it. And hopefully through your network, you don't have to make, they can help you avoid some of the mistakes, and some of the mistakes you do make, they help you become better. And just like sports, it's a culmination of all of that, that will hopefully lead to a good finished product. Which, well, by the way, I'm not a finished product. I'm still working.
No disagreement there. I would say, though, some would argue, Earl, by the time you showed up to Brown, you may have been somewhat of a finished product in terms of prolific scoring, because, you know, somebody that averages about 19 points a game consistently, I would say you were in good shape during the course of your freshman year.
Yeah, I appreciate that.
Well, I'm glad you brought up the term networking, because that brings me to you really remaining tied to Brown, even to this day. You were recently elected to be a trustee to the corporation of Brown University. I believe that happened last spring. And now you obviously have the opportunity to take part in meetings and so forth. What did that mean to you to now, as somebody in the professional realm in finance, to be able to be involved in sort of the day-to-day operations of the university?
Well, one, it's an honor to be elected to serve Brown. It's a place that had such a profound impact on my life, and something I care deeply about and passionately. And it's really, it was the start of driving a lot of the success that I have now, is things that I learned really during those formative years. I think it's more when something gives you so much, you want to give back. And I think that's been rooted for me from when I was young. If you take, you have to give, and so forth. And I've actually found the community to be warm and something that I've wanted to stay connected to, and I've really benefited from. And really, it didn't start off with me wanting to be on the board of trustees. It started off smaller. It started off when I was there, and I was asked to serve on an advisory council. And then when I graduated, they asked young alumni to participate. Then it was time for your five-year reunion, and I was asked to participate. It's all things that I wanted to do. And then the new president came on, and there were some alumni she reached out to that had been involved. And I was able to forge a relationship with Chris and really believed in her vision for the university. And that drew me further in. Then there were other alumni that I would meet through this, and it really just fed upon itself. And, you know, while it was only 4 years of your life, I feel like that community has continued to be a big part of my life, and it's been much more than those 4 years.
You brought up that, which I find interesting, you were on an advisory committee when you were a student, correct?
Yes.
In terms of your interaction, and then, you know, worked your way up since graduating and taking part of these other activities. When you're a student, as any of us can attest to, you get so caught up into your schoolwork, basketball practice. I'm curious, from now being a trustee and serving on some of these committees, Earl, how much has it provided a different perspective of what it takes to run a prestigious university like Brown?
Wow. Well, listen, I would say leadership, you know, and I would actually say from the roles that I've had in finance, management and leadership matter. And there's so much that go into running an operation like a Brown or any of these Ivy League schools. You know, there's a lot of accountability, and it's operationally intensive, and the missions of the school are so important. You want to make sure you get it right. So to answer your question in short, as I've been on these committees, I found out how extensive and how much work and being thoughtful goes into running a university. And I've been amazed. I'm just glad we have the right team that can handle the job.
Well, before we wrap up, I want to circle back to basketball, speaking of team, because as you alluded to earlier, Mike Martin, your teammate, is now the head coach at Brown, and he's been able to achieve a great deal of success since he has taken over as the head man. How much do you like the fact that you're able to stay connected to the current team because of your tie to Mike Martin? Maybe how irritated were you that he's almost pushing the record that you set over the course of your 3 years in terms of the amount of wins you were able to post?
Well, there's nothing that would make me happier than for him to break that record. I feel fortunate that someone who I believe in and played with and I think is just such a great representative of the school is the head coach now. It clearly ties me even more to the program than maybe I would have been otherwise, even playing there. And I just know we're in such good hands. And I think he's a very good leader of people. And I know he's preparing these young men for not only excellence on the court, which I obviously fully believe in, but I think when student athletes make the decision to come to an Ivy League school and play in the Ivy League, it's a big sacrifice, and you alluded to it earlier, and they have the academic rigor they have to manage. I think it's on us as leaders and administrators to make sure they're getting just as much out of that for when they're done playing at Brown and can lead productive and going to do really excellent things. So I can't say how much it means to me to have Mike there. As I said, leadership matters, and we have a great one in Mike Martin.
Well, as a follow-up to that, as somebody who has called Ivy League basketball for many years, Earl, the one thing I appreciate just as being an observer is how competitive the league is from really top down. And as you can attest to, any given night on the back-to-back setup, anybody can beat anybody. And I think that was really brought to the forefront even during the course of your playing days from 1999 to 2003. How much do you think that may not get enough attention in terms of not just the quality of the academics that you just talked about, but the quality that complements that on the playing surface, specifically on the hardwood?
Yeah, I mean, listen, I think, you know, as I watched the league and you talked about it, on any given night, any of these teams can beat almost any team in the country. I think the amount of parity in college basketball in general now is more than it's ever been. One, there's at the top level, some of those players are leaving to play professionally early. So you're not having that same difference of dominance for like the top 10 teams in the country. And then I think there's just a lot of good basketball around the country. And also college basketball is a guard dominated game. And as you know, calling. So I think you can find a lot of great players. I know some of the Ivy League big guys aren't going to like what I have to say here, but you can find excellent players under 6'5", almost in any playground in the country at this point. It's harder to find that 6'8", 6'9", and 6'10 elite player. So for a game that's dominated by guards, it leads to a lot of parity. And I also think the Ivy League is interesting in the back-to-back. I think that also adds to that parity because the second night, you know, one team may be a little bit more dominant, but if you're traveling on that second night, you're a little tired. It's truly amateur basketball at its best. And I think it's pretty fun.
College basketball dominated by guards, spoken like a true former guard yourself. I'll remember that line.
I don't know if I should say that. You know, that's probably not, as I said, the big guys probably don't like hearing that, but that's the way I see it.
Well, listen, Earl, as a former point guard myself, not necessarily playing at the highest level that you did, I will certainly attest and support your cause for the guard play. I'm all okay for that. So not a problem. Well, listen, greatly appreciate you joining us. It was very interesting to reminisce about your basketball career, and I wish you the best of luck in your new pursuits on the financial side.
Perfect. Thank you.
So that is Earl Hunt joining us here on the Rooted in Ivy series as we weigh in with former Ivy League athletes and delve in to what they're doing in their current professional realm. Lance Meadow with you. Thanks for joining us here on Rooted in Ivy, the latest Ivy League series.